G'day guys and welcome back to another video. In today's video, we're gonna dive deep into mixing frame rates in LumaFusion, also how we can play around with different aspects depending on the cameras that we film with, if we have different aspects we want to integrate into one video, and also the resolution. Now, resolution doesn't really matter and doesn't really do much other than changing the quality of the video. So by maintaining 1080p and upwards, you're gonna have a smooth image and a pretty crisp image anyway. Now, I've seen a lot of videos where there is so much stutter and jitter and it's just awful to watch. So, you know, I click away immediately. So the goal for today is that you're gonna understand exactly how to avoid this so you can have perfectly smooth videos in the future and you really don't have to worry about shooting with different frame rates, whether you want to speed something up or slow something down. But before we head over to the iPad, if this is the first time that you are checking out my videos, welcome, really nice to see you, and thanks a lot for clicking on this video and stopping by. If you haven't already, hit that subscribe button. We're so close to 100,000 subscribers, and that would be really appreciated if you wanted to support that way. There's also a brand new preset collection coming for LumaFusion very, very soon, almost done. Takes forever to make it, but there is also someone that has dropped a Soon transition pack and also a Whip Pan transition pack, which has some elastic changes to it, elastic transitions, which is really, really awesome. And it's really hard to pull off, but I think it turned out pretty good. So let's use that transition to transition into the iPad and get this tutorial started. So now that we moved over to LumaFusion, let's take a look at the clips here we're gonna use in the same project. Now, taking a look at the left-hand side here, we can see there's so many clips here with different frame rates and resolution. The resolution and frame rates doesn't really matter, and the aspect doesn't really matter either because we can change that within LumaFusion, and we're gonna come back to that in just a sec. Now, if we take a look at the clips here, we can see that most of the clips actually contains FPS between 23.98 and 30. So that means you're gonna pick either one for your project depending on the export settings that you want. For me personally, I always export in 23.98, but this video is actually exported in 30 FPS. Now, there is a few things that you need to sort of prepare for when you select your timeline FPS, and that is the majority of the clip, what is the FPS of those, and the final export of your project. So let's say you have a bunch of clips, but you really want to export in 30 FPS, and most of these clips are 30 FPS, but you have a few clips which is 24, maybe 25, and even 60 FPS. So the way that we mix all these together is pretty simple. It all comes down to adjusting the speed of the clip. If you don't adjust the speed of the clip, you will end up having clips which is jittery, and you can see the jitter going on throughout the clip, especially if it has fast movement. So the faster the movement of your clip is, the more jitter you're gonna have if it's not matched and adjusted according to the FPS of your timeline. So if we move over and create a project here, let's say we want to have this as 30 FPS, we're gonna select 30 FPS, and we're gonna just select the standard 16:9 landscape aspect ratio, and the color space, we're just gonna keep it to standard Rec. 709. So now that we created this project, let's go on and import some different clips here. We can see here the timeline is 30 FPS, so that means most of our clips will have to be, or all of our clips has to be 30 FPS in some way. Whether it's the raw frame rate from the clip, or the clip has some changes in speed to match up to the 30 FPS timeline. Now, going through the timeline here, trimming everything down a tiny bit, we have some clips here which is 30 FPS. Now, these will play back smoothly without any jitter, no matter what, because they have the matching frame rates of our project. But if we import some different clips here, we have some drone shots which has different frame rates. This is a 23.98. And if we play that back, you can see that we have some jitter going on, and it's especially noticeable at the right side of the cliff here. You can also see down on the rocks on the bottom of the shoreline, but we have some more clips here, which is 23.98. And if you pay attention to the cliff on the left side here, on the top, which is closest to the camera, you can see some spikes going on there. Now, let's find another clip here to import. We can take this, which is 25 FPS. So we have a timeline, which is 30 FPS now, right? But we have clips, which is 30 FPS, and we have 23.98, and we also have one, which is 25. Now, the 25 is gonna be less jittery because it's closer to the frame rate of the project, but you will see some, but not as much coming from the 23.98 clip. Now, let's find a clip here, which is 60 FPS, so this is above 30 FPS, which means that you won't see that much jitter in this clip, but you have more room to work with because you can slow down the clip if you want to. So you're not going to have any frame drops in a clip which has a higher frame rate than the project timeline. That's why most people are making their videos in 23.98 as a project FPS timeline, and then rather slow down the clips to make them super cinematic and flow better. Now, since this clip is 60 FPS, that means in a 30 FPS timeline, we don't have to slow it down unless we want to. So for every clip which has a higher frame rate than what you have on your timeline, you don't need to slow them down if you don't want to. But for every clip which has a lower FPS than the FPS set on your timeline, so let's say for this clip here, which is 23.98 FPS in a 30 FPS timeline, to prevent any jitter from this clip right here, we will need to go into the edit section and then go over to the speed changes, and we will have to increase the speed of this clip to make it match that 30 FPS timeline. You can also see that down here underneath the slider that the 23.98 FPS clip is in a 30 FPS project. What's good about LumaFusion is that you have these indicators as well, which is showing you exactly where the speed of this clip should be. Doesn't matter what type of clip you throw on your timeline, as long as you do the speed changes to the clip to match the project timeline, you will have a perfectly smooth image without any frame drops and without any jitter. So moving through the timeline and the clips here, all the clips has different frame rates and different resolutions. So when it comes to the resolution, it doesn't really matter what type of resolution you mix together, as long as all the clips has the same aspect. So all the clips here has the aspect of 16:9. And if we take a look at this clip right here, this has a different aspect. This has the aspect of 4000 to 1700. And if we go into this clip, we can see that the edges of the clip is actually outside of the frame. And if we go over to fit mode, we can see that the fit mode is set to fill up the entire frame of the preview screen here, the preview section, so we don't have any black spots. Now, we can also choose fit to get the entire image within the frame, but since this has a different aspect, we will no longer have the video on the top and bottom of the preview screen. Now, you can change this by adding some cinematic bars if you really want the most of the footage to be within the frame, or if you want it to fit perfectly within the preview screen and you don't want to adjust by adding some cinematic bars or anything like that, you can choose the fit mode fill. When it comes to stretch, this will also fill the entire preview screen, but it will squeeze the image down in some way and it will look a little bit weird depending on the aspect of your video. Now, if you have a super cinematic 2.27 or 26 or something like that, and your like super ultra wide clip, you might have a clip that looks like this within the preview screen. Now, this can be easily manipulated by adding a few keyframes, so it depends what you want the viewer to see. So if we create a keyframe at the beginning at this point and another one, and we change the placement of the clip here, you can still manipulate manipulate this to move something or to have something in frame and sort of animate that to maintain what you want the viewers to see. So at the end, it doesn't really matter what type of frame rates that you have on your project. So if we move over and change this from 30 FPS down to 24 FPS, just make a duplicate and change of that, we now have a project which is 24 FPS, and that means for the clips which is 23.98 and 30 FPS and so on, there is minor adjustments that we need to do. So if we go into some of these clips here, let's start with this one right here. You can see instead of speeding up the clip now, we can put it back to normal because 23.98 and 24 FPS is somewhat exactly the same. So we won't have any frame drops here either. And we can go over to the 30 FPS, which is now you have the option to slow that down or let it play because the clip now has a higher FPS than the timeline. So the clip is 30 FPS and the timeline is 24. And that means you won't have any frame drops and you can choose whether you want to slow it down or maintain the normal speed. So my point is the lower the FPS of the project is, the better and smoother workflow you're going to have because it's going to be easier. You can select and choose whether you want to slow down a clip or not. But if you have a higher timeline FPS like 30 FPS and if you add clips which is below 30 FPS, that means you will have to, you basically have no choice than to go in and adjust the speed, otherwise you will have the jitter in your image. Now let's size these projects up a bit and I'm going to show you the example here. So the first one is exported at 23.98 FPS and the next one is 30 FPS. And remember earlier I said that this video you're watching right now is exported in 30 FPS. That means the first clip you're about to see, which is exported at 23.98, is going to have jitter, whilst the second one, which is exported in the same frame rate as the video is recorded and exported with to here on YouTube, is going to have no jitter at all. So let's take a look at that and see the difference. So there you have the simple and easy way of mixing different frame rates together in one project. Like I said, I always recommend that you use 23.98 or 30 FPS. It depends on what you shoot the most with. If 30 FPS is what you always shoot with, then stick to 30 FPS on your timeline and then, you know, you try to film everything above 30 FPS and not underneath 30 FPS. Or if it doesn't matter for you, then stick with 23.98 because you will have the most flexibility in post-production and you can always slow down if you want to and you don't really have to speed up. The worst thing is to speed up the clips that you don't want to be sped up, but this is to prevent stutter and jitter and all that awful, you know, So let me know down in the comment section below what you thought of this video. Next video, I think we're so close to that one as well, the 3D infinite seamless transition. Yes, I think it was so close to have that done here as well. So I think that is going to be the next video. So stay tuned for that. And again, if this was the first time, I really hope that you enjoyed today's content. And if you made it this far, all the way at the bottom of the description, there is going to be a download link to some free presets. I'm thinking about integrating that in every single video, so if you stick along, you might find out where the link is. No password, nothing like that. It's just, you know, tap on it and you download. And this is only going to be available for 24 hours, just to keep you here a little bit longer, you know. So with that said, thanks for watching, and the subscribe button is all the way down there if you haven't already. 100,000 subscribers coming up soon, I hope. That would be awesome to see that 100K subscriber mark, or to get to that. Anyway, that's gonna be the end for today. I'll see you in the next one.